The mountain of Isandlwana in eastern South Africa. On the 22nd of January 1879, this was the site of one of the most humiliating defeats ever suffered by the British Army. In just 3 hours, over 1,200 British troops, armed with state-of-the-art weapons, were annihilated by an African army equipped only with spears, shields, and a collection of old muskets. The enemy responsible captured the British imagination and went down in history as one of the most fearsome and powerful kingdoms in Africa, the Zulu. We know less about Africa's past than almost anywhere else on Earth. But the scarcity of written records doesn't mean Africa lacks history. In this series, I'm exploring some of the richest and most vibrant histories in the world.
I'm traveling across South Africa through some of the country's most spectacular landscapes to discover how a tiny ethnic group born in a period of turmoil could become one of the most famous and celebrated kingdoms in history.
Every February, a few thousand people gather to celebrate contemporary Zulu identity by taking part in a traditional South African ceremony. This First Fruits Festival is dedicated to the small yellow marula fruit native to the country. The crowds have come here to present the first harvest of the marula to their leader, King Goodwill Zwelithini. According to tradition, the king must be the first to taste the fruit before the people can harvest their crops.
What's happening here is more than just a celebration of Zulu culture. It's an affirmation of the power of the king who's the embodiment of the state, and a connection to the great monarchs that founded the Zulu nation.
Zulu identity was shaped by a series of powerful kings. According to oral tradition, the original Zulu chiefdom was established in the 17th century by the founding patriarch, Malandela. It was his son Zulu who gave his name to the people. Zulu means heaven. They became known as the AmaZulu, the people of heaven. They settled in a region that would eventually become known as KwaZulu-Natal. Bounded by the Drakensberg Mountains in the west and the Indian Ocean in the east, it's a landscape of rolling hills, deep river gorges, and fertile grasslands.
I do love this bit of South Africa, KwaZulu-Natal. There's something about it that feels very authentic. I mean, so much of South Africa is so like Europe, but this feels really like Africa.
At the end of the 18th century, the Zulu were just one of a patchwork of small chiefdoms that occupied this region. For over 100 years, they'd lived in relative peace, raising cattle and cultivating their fields. But then, everything began to change. Trade was the catalyst for the transformation of the Zulu people from a small local chiefdom into a major regional power. Europeans had been trading in southern Africa since the 16th century. On the west coast, the Dutch and later the British controlled the city of Cape Town, while closer to Zulu territory, the Portuguese had a trading post at Delagoa Bay. In exchange for ivory, cattle and slaves, the Portuguese and other European traders supplied copper, brass, textiles and beads. But trouble was brewing.
By the end of the 18th century, rival ethnic groups were competing more and more aggressively for access to trade routes that linked to Delagoa Bay. Trade with the Portuguese was vital for local power and influence, but not everyone would get access.
Small chieftains were in danger of being crushed by their larger rivals in the fight for goods to trade with the Europeans. The small Zulu chieftain was suddenly vulnerable.
But out of that turmoil would emerge a man who would change Zulu history forever. His name, Shaka.
Shaka was a king and a soldier and the founder of the Zulu nation. In the space of 12 years, in the early 19th century, he transformed the small Zulu chiefdom into a large and powerful military force. Although he became an icon of the Zulu people, Shaka's legacy remains deeply contentious, something not helped by the myths that surround his biography.
What's really frustrating about Shaka's life is that there are hardly any contemporaneous written records. We have to rely on second-hand written material and oral testimonies, most of which is conflicting.
The lack of reliable evidence has left room for multiple interpretations of Shaka, many of them highly romanticized. Respected sources suggest he was born in the 1780s, the eldest son of a Zulu chief. For reasons unknown, he was raised in a neighboring chiefdom, where he learned the skills of statecraft and soldiering. As inter-ethnic conflict erupted, he returned to the Zulus, seized the chieftaincy, and transformed the lives of his people. One legend portrays Shaka as a benevolent patriarch. As a young man, he is said to have worked as a herdsman. One day, he was out in the fields when he was distracted. As a result, he lost his herd. The shame he felt had a profound effect, according to the story.
Shaka learned from his early experience as a herdsman that it was important to look after every single member of your flock. He spent the rest of his life trying to compensate, making sure that security and discipline were the central focus of Zulu life.
To explore one view of how Shaka built the Zulu kingdom, I'm meeting Makawi Biela, a descendant of Shaka himself.
Before Shaka, there was no Zulu Empire. Shaka, through his intelligence, is the one who created the Zulu Empire. After he came to the throne, he said, okay, now what I'm going to do, I will go from clan to clan. Chieftain, I will approach each and every chief, and I will just unite people using the spear. I united them in order for me to establish the great Zulu Empire.
But were people scared of him, or did they respect him, or was it a mixture of the two?
Mixture of the two. Some feared him, because for those who refused to join his faction, you know, they knew very well what would happen to them.
Yeah.
A spear would be put into you. There are so many other people who said, no, we cannot tolerate this. We cannot live under your control.
But there must have been good reasons why people stayed within the Zulu nation. What was so attractive about the Zulu state that Shaka was building? What were the wonderful things that he was giving to the people that they didn't have before?
Well, the thing that people never had, they were not united. They were like having small clans here and there. He was emphasizing unity. No separation, no isolation, no quarrel, nothing. He is trying to unite the people. He's trying to create our identity as Zulu people.
Many Zulu today venerate Shaka as the protector and defender of the people. They give him credit for reforming an institution that shaped Zulu identity and transformed its fortunes, the army. These warriors are members of a ceremonial Zulu regiment. Today, they perform on formal occasions. But in Shaka's time, regiments were the backbone of Zulu society.
When Shaka assumed the throne in 1816, he decided to build upon recent innovations of local chiefs. He introduced a system of conscription, divided his soldiers into regiments called Amabutu, and these were to revolutionize Zulu society.
Under the Amabutu system, young men left their families around the age of 14 to work and fight in regiments. Separating young men from the rest of Zulu society was a way of shifting their loyalty from local chiefs to their Amabutu and their king. One of the leaders of the regiment is Ungumizi.
Umbuto for the start. Ibuto. Ibuto manga bukula umnanu tata ukalu pegu gutungaba yizwa. Ukona loko twanga mabuto ngabimbube keeping kunzi ofela pagati ganjalo ganjalo neabutwa. Ubutwa wenu lapon swenezel ugumela ubuntu benu noma umela isizulu njoba singakwazi. Sinamagama ethu nje njengokuthi mina ngizalwe kunye nawe kodwa sibuthwe kanye kanye kuthiwe siwe inqaba embube ukhipha inkunzi umanukelana ufela phakathi kwakubuthwa for the start
to the military system. It's actually part of the culture, and the culture is part of the military system, that in a way it's absolutely fundamental to Zulu culture.
Yes.
Under Shaka, young men in the Amabutu were not allowed to marry and set up their own homesteads. Marriage rights could only be earned once soldiers had reached maturity and distinguished themselves in battle, normally around the age of 35. By making marriage a reward for military service, Shaka ensured the loyalty of his men. Shaka's also credited with introducing new fighting techniques, including a new battle formation that proved brilliantly effective. It became known as the Horns of the Buffalo.
Simon, can you tell me about the battle formation that the Zulu used?
Regiment leader Simon is giving me a demonstration.
So this is the enemy here. Uh-huh. How would the Horns of the Buffalo actually work? If that was the enemy that was approaching the Zulu lines, how would it...
Can I draw it down?
Yeah, what? Please do.
Yes. The buffalo horn shape, it's like this.
What they would engage with this group here, is that...
This
is the chest.
Of warriors. Where the very strong and the strongest men used to stand. All these youngsters, all this round left and right, they surround an enemy, and then the enemy will be in the middle now. They will kill him dead.
To illustrate the battle technique more clearly, Simon's arranging his warriors into the attack formation.
This is what I'm talking about.
So this is a strategy that Shaka actually invented, that they would form the horns of a buffalo.
Yes.
At the actual head are the strongest men.
Yes.
And that they would hit the enemy
hit the enemy really hard.
And then whilst the enemy is trying to deal with these big guys, the two horns come round. And they enclose you.
Yes.
And they finish you off.
They finish off. This is how he conquered so many tribes.
Wow.
And make it one big tribe. Zulu Nation.
So they're actually singing, "We are the bull, but we will destroy you." I mean, that metaphor of cattle, it's obviously so deeply infused into the Zulu. And it's just amazing to see it brought to life in these kinds of performances.
Shaka also transformed Zulu weaponry